very good morning to one and all. Welcome to TaiCon Kerala 2013. Tai was established over 20 years ago to foster entrepreneurship through mentoring, networking, and education. Today, it has more than 20,000 members and over 2,500 charter members in 61 chapters across 14 countries. Tai Kerala was established over 10 years ago to fulfill Tai's vision in our state. Started with humble beginnings, today, Tai Kerala boasts of 41 charter members and 165 associate members who are CEOs in a plethora of industries. We are here to witness one of its major initiatives, TaiCon Kerala. Now in its second year of existence, TaiCon Kerala is one of its kind mega entrepreneurship event. We have over 75 illustrious speakers and an exciting array of sessions planned over the next 2 days. None other than the Honorable Chief Minister of Kerala is present with us to inaugurate the two-day conclave, which will see eminent international corporate leaders, entrepreneurs, and venture capital companies exchanging ideas with aspiring entrepreneurs and startup companies. Before we start the events of the day, let us watch a video on entrepreneurship with specific reference to Kerala. I request you all to sit back and take a journey with us on the story of entrepreneurship.
For all the development that mankind has achieved since millennia, it was not until the year 1827 that the matchstick was first invented. It was an idea that took shape in the mind of English chemist John Walker, an idea he successfully brought to fruition. Thousands of such ideas are born daily, but only a few of them are destined to see the light of day. For it takes more than just dreams to bring ideas to life. It takes passion, dedication, and really hard work. At times rewarding, and at times ruthlessly disappointing. But sooner or later, the results show up, and the dream becomes a reality, making the world a better place for all of us to live in. India, home to one of the world's oldest civilizations and the earliest centers of knowledge and learning. Once the world's wealthiest region, she lost her glory to foreign domination. Now a resurgent country, united in her diversity, India is striving to catch up with the developed world. During the last few decades, a few ordinary people with extraordinary vision helped change the lives of millions of fellow Indians through the power of entrepreneurship. These were people who dared to dream big, who had the courage to venture out into the unknown, working hard to turn their ideas into action, in the process creating institutions of excellence. They not only created employment, they created wealth. And they distributed this wealth. They helped to put India on the path to prosperity. Every geography of India, there is someone who made a mark, starting with nothing but an idea and the fire within to make it big as an entrepreneur. Kerala, God's own country, has been the birthplace of many an outstanding and path-breaking entrepreneur who made their mark through the relentless pursuit of excellence, creating hugely successful enterprises in different parts of the world. Entrepreneurship has been the single most influential factor in changing the way we live our lives in modern society. Entrepreneurs play a crucial role in shaping our society, creating new products, providing new jobs. Silicon Valley, USA has been the cradle that has nurtured many highly successful Indian entrepreneurs over the last three decades. One such group of visionary entrepreneurs with roots in the Indus region decided to help foster the spirit of entrepreneurship in India and across the world. The Indus Entrepreneurs, popularly known as TIE, was born in 1992 in Silicon Valley. TIE globally has over 11,000 members with 60 chapters across 17 countries. Dedicated to the virtuous cycle of wealth creation and giving back to the community, TIE's focus is on generating and nurturing the next generation of entrepreneurs. The Kerala chapter of TIE Global was launched in 2003 by a group of like-minded professionals who shared their vision with its founders. Professionals who were passionate about entrepreneurship and its benefits to the state of Kerala.
In the last 10 years, TIE Kerala has been able to create a platform for fostering entrepreneurship through networking, education and mentoring.
Kerala's transformation in the recent past with the proliferation of many startup enterprises in technology, tourism, manufacturing, healthcare, financial services and retail has been phenomenal.
This is the best time to start enterprises in Kerala. We have the ideal environment. We have the right government policies, we have the business incubators, we have venture funds, we have angel funds. So if you're looking at doing something, I don't think you can find a better time.
Many promising enterprises have been kick-started and have flourished since the last two decades. Most of them were sparked by the passion of individuals to start something on their own. Some even quitting their well-paying, high-profile jobs to strive towards something they dreamt of.
I am interested in innovation and new ideas. And therefore, one day I decided to take the plunge and leave my civil service career and set up a venture of my own. This was 25 years ago.
When I was in trouble, means after about 13 years of my service in a small scale industry, and the organization where I was working that was closed. So I thought of starting a very small, tiny industry without any capital. In other words, with the 5,000 rupees, I started this organization.
When we think about entrepreneurship, I believe hard work and determination is the first point comes into my mind. Delegation and teamwork are the another major points which we have to follow to be successful.
In your entrepreneurial journey, you should be willing to accept failures. From every failure, you will have something to learn. And only when you learn, next time you will succeed.
Entrepreneurship is a joyous journey that one can undertake. It's a journey which is both challenging and very fulfilling. It's about people, it's about fulfillment, it's about your commitment, and it's about creating yourself in a better world.
As a first generation entrepreneur, all I have to say is that it is very critical that the focus on the enterprise is a very important aspect. And the second aspect is it is not important that whom you know, but it is important what you know. The content and the knowledge is also another critical element of entrepreneurship.
Suntech is a software products company focusing on telecom and banking software products. Our customers are in 53 odd countries. In that sense, we truly are a global software product company from Kerala.
When we started MobMe in 2006, I was in third year in college. A community of entrepreneurs came together to help me build my dream. Today, that same community is coming together to help build Startup Village, where over 1,000 youngsters are coming to build their own dreams and destinies to change the future of our nation.
I have only one suggestion to aspiring entrepreneurs of the state. There is no shortcut to success. You must have the perseverance and the determination to pursue the right goal and continue that path. One day, it's only a matter of time, you will succeed.
Entrepreneurship is not only important for Kerala, it is very much important for our country itself. I would see the future of our state very clearly linked to the number of entrepreneurs that we actually create. we need more job creators in the state than job seekers.
പുതിയ സംരംഭകരായിട്ടുള്ളവരോട് എനിക്ക് പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് പറയാനുള്ളത്, ഏത് സംരംഭം തുടങ്ങിയാലും അതിനടിസ്ഥാനപരമായ നമ്മുടെ പണസമ്പാദനം മാത്രമായിട്ട് കണക്കെടുക്കരുത്. നമ്മൾ എന്ത് സമ്പാദിച്ചാലും സമ്പാദനം, ഇപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ ഇനീഷ്യൽ ലെവലിലേക്ക് വന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞ് കുറേ പണമൊക്കെ കിട്ടിക്കഴിയുമ്പോൾ വിചാരിക്കും ഓ പണം കിട്ടിയെല്ലാം നടന്നല്ലോ എന്ന് വിചാരിക്കാതെ, അത് പണമില്ലാത്തവരെ ഒരു ഏരിയ ഉണ്ട് നമുക്ക്, അത് സാധുക്കളായിട്ടുള്ളവർ സഹായിക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു ഏരിയ കൂടെ കണ്ടെത്തുന്നത് നന്നായിരിക്കും.
It is now the turn of Kerala to shine as the new destination for setting up startup ventures. And Thai Kerala will be there to help them bring their ideas to life, holding their hands through the journey from startup to enterprise. As we hold this second edition of ThaiCon Kerala, let us salute all those visionary entrepreneurs from the state who, through their sheer vision and hard work, created institutions of enduring value and brought life and joy to millions of homes around the world. ThaiCon Kerala 2013. Celebrating entrepreneurship. Celebrate the future.
Let's begin today's event with lighting the traditional lamp. I request Sri John K. Paul, President Thai Kerala, to accompany the Honorable Chief Minister to the stage. I also request Sri A.V. George, Vice President Thai Kerala, and Sri S.R. Nair, Charter Member Thai Kerala, to accompany Sri Ashok Rao, Chairman Thai Global, Dr. Bernard Harris, Director, President and CEO Vesalius Ventures, Sri P.H. Kurian, IAS Principal Secretary, Department of Industries, Government of Kerala, and Dr. M. Srinatha Shastri, CGM State Bank of India. I request you all to please light the Kuthuvalaka. Thank you, gentlemen. For the welcome address, I would like to call upon Sri A.V. George, Vice President of Thai Kerala. Sri A.V. George is a reputed industrialist both in Kerala and at the national level. He's the chairman of the AVG Group of Companies, which is one of the largest and oldest business groups in the state of Kerala. The AVG Group is a diversified multi-crore business with 8 businesses in its fold. Mr. A.V. George is presently a member of the Rubber Board, Government of India. He's also the chairman WWF India, Kerala State Committee. I request Sri A.V. George to welcome the gathering.
Honorable Chief Minister of Kerala, Sri Uman Chandy. Thai Kerala President, Mr. John K. Paul, Mr. Ashok Rao, Chairman, Thai Global, Dr. Bernard Harris, Mr. P.H. Kurian, Principal Secretary, Government of Kerala, and Dr. Srinatha Shastri, Chief General Manager, State Bank of India, and Mr. S.R. Nair. On behalf of Thai Kerala, let me first, at the outset, wish you all all the season's greetings and a warm welcome. Thai Kerala is happy and proud that we are staging the second edition of Thai Kerala today and tomorrow at this august venue of Lee Meridian Resort and Convention Center, Cochin. You have already seen the video this morning, which shows you the history of where Thai started and where it is today. And the next 2 days, we propose to focus on sectors that are today greenfields in nature and hold immense scope for the growth in Kerala, like tourism, hospitality, wellness, healthcare, IT and ITES, women's entrepreneurship, retail, education, manufacturing, genomics. And for the first time, we are also having a pitch festival where new people who are starting up or propose to start up can pitch in front of VCs and angel investors who may be able to take them up to the next level. And as usual, we will also be having the mentoring track. Instead of 4 tracks of last year, we are having 6 tracks, which include these 2. And the details of these will be explained to you by Mr. S.R. Nair later towards the end of this first session. But let me now get on with the pleasant duty to extend a warm welcome to our distinguished guests present here. Uman Chandy, Chief Minister of Kerala. I don't think we have seen another Chief Minister who has gone out and met so many people ever in the history of Kerala. Forget Kerala, whole of India. And there's no one as open as him, and he has been one of the people who are instrumental in encouraging the entrepreneurship mission of Kerala and the new path which he has taken is a real encouragement to all of us here. And this is shown by, if you look at the GDP growth in 11-12, while India grew at 6.5%, Kerala grew at 9.5%. And last year, when India grew at 5%, Kerala is still growing at about 9%. Where did this growth come from? We have the least amount of FDIs. This growth has come from the small entrepreneurs, from the MSME and minor sectors which have come in. And these job creators have made Kerala one of the places with the least amount of unemployment. So you are one of the people who are responsible for all this. And we bow and salute you for this. And I welcome you on behalf of all of us. See, John K. Paul needs no mention in the Thai community, as he's been leading Thai Kerala for the last 3 years. The Managing Director of Popular Vehicles and Services and Director and Partner of Popular and Katakaran Group of Companies. He has been instrumental in organizing and getting Thai organized so that it's on his initiative that the Thaicons have started. And on behalf of all of you, I extend a hearty welcome to him. Mr. Ashok Rao, Chairman Thai Global. Ashok has been holding the torch of Thai for the last few years. And you can see how Thai has grown. I think now the figure is how much? 62? 62 chapters. And it's growing almost at about 2-3 countries every year. And with him, he's done a tremendous job of taking this thing of fostering entrepreneurship around the world. On behalf of Thai Kerala, I welcome you, sir. Dr. Bernard A. Harris, Jr. What do we call him? He's a doctor. He's a pilot. He's an engineer. I mean, he's everything. He's an astronaut, and now he's an entrepreneur. He has been investing in companies which are basically into the healthcare department. And he has just landed early this morning, and I'm very happy to see him. I didn't know if he will ever be able to get up and open his eyes, because he's been traveling through the night and not slept. I, on behalf of Thai, welcome him and his lovely wife this morning, on behalf of Thai. Sir P.H. Kurian is currently the Principal Secretary of Principal Secretary Industry and Commerce and IT. So he's got many, many caps on his head. In fact, Mr. Kurian was selected one of the 50 most influential global personalities in the field of intellectual property, consecutively for 2 years in 2009 and 2010. Because this was when he was the Controller General of Patents, Designs and Trademarks under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. He, with his landmark decision of judgment, granting compulsory license to anti-drug Nexwear, thereby reducing the market price from 2,80,000 to 80,000, has made the drug accessible to common men. And he has shown his capabilities right from when he was a collector, when I knew him as a collector of Kottayam. From then, even small things like when I was trying out fish farming with Paddy, he was one of the people who encouraged me in that. And sir, on behalf of Thai Kerala, I extend you a warm welcome. Dr. M. Srinatha Shastri is the Chief General Manager of SBI Kerala Circle. Dr. Shastri joined the bank in 1983 and has risen through various departments of the bank. And he is a PhD in physics, a chartered financial analyst, a financial risk manager certification from the Global Association of Risk Professionals. And today, we're happy to have you here, sir. And I would like to, on behalf of Thai, while extending you a hearty welcome, also thank you for being the presenting sponsor of this conference. Thank you. And finally, I would like to thank, we have over 100 speakers today for the first time, compared to about 80 odd in the last ICON. And I would like to I welcome all of them, including all the startup entrepreneurs, the students, the volunteers, and all the delegates over here. And I hope you will have a fruitful session in the next 2 days. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next will be the presidential address by Sri John K. Paul, the president of Thai Kerala. As the Managing Director of Popular Vehicles and Services Limited, he was instrumental in diversifying the Popular Group into many areas during the last three decades. A true entrepreneur, he's also the brainchild behind Tycon Kerala. I request Sri John K. Paul to please address the gathering. Sir?
The Honorable Chief Minister, Mr. Uman Chandy, Mr. Ashok Rao, Chairman, Thai Global, Dr. Bernard Harris, Director, President, and CEO, Resilience Ventures, Mr. P.H. Kurian, IAS, Principal Secretary, Department of Industries, Government of Kerala, Mr. Shastri, CGM, State Bank of India, distinguished guests, media, personnel, Time members, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Last year's Tycon 2012 was a first of its kind mega event organized by the Kerala chapter. But we didn't realize that its tremendous success would create a legacy, driving us with more passion to launch Tycon 2013. Our membership rose from 167 to over 500 now. Hopefully, let this legacy continue, creating ripples among the entrepreneurs, corporates, the government, students, and the civil society, inching us closer to our mission, an entrepreneur in every home by 2020. 1 year hence, our belief in this mission has grown manifold. Thai Kerala believes that it can and should happen in our state because that is the only way forward. Our Honorable Chief Minister, Sri Uman Chandy, is creating ripples in the state too with his popular mass contact program. As he said, the program is not just an effort to redress grievances, but the beginning of a continuous process to revamp the administrative machinery. Earlier programs enabled him to realize that certain outdated laws render even the bureaucracy helpless. He not only issued orders to solve these issues, but also promised that such laws would be amended. We call upon our Chief Minister to initiate a similar exercise among the entrepreneurs in the state, to understand the problems faced by them and also his creative intervention in its redressal. Here too, drawbacks of the existing laws would come to light, as would the limitations of our bureaucracy, as Kerala can only through entrepreneurship. We cannot afford to move on with small, feeble steps and initiatives. We need a paradigm shift in our system. Often, our comparison on economic growth are with the states that do well, like Tamil Nadu or Gujarat, for instance. If we can replace this myopic vision with a broader one and have the close look at countries that flourish most rapidly, then we will realize that it is the conducive environment of entrepreneurship that worked for them. Historically, we missed the Industrial Revolution and a major part of the Computer Revolution, but we are now in the era of a Mobile Revolution, and we must make the most of it. The world itself has shrunk to be confined to our fingers, and we have almost everything at our disposal, just a finger touch away. Technology couldn't have been better than this. Let this euphoria surge ahead in Kerala too, because if not now, it may never happen again. We need more innovation and entrepreneurship. We need better infrastructure to allow people with great ideas to put them to work, to start their own businesses, and to allow them to earn their way out of the individual and collective challenges. For Kerala to move forward and to attain development, it needs a very comprehensive plan. The Kerala Thai Kerala will always be at the forefront to aid the government in creating a vision for our state. When it comes to promoting entrepreneurship, so far we have relied on concepts like single window or 90-day clearance. But unlike an authoritarian rule, it is pretty difficult for getting clearances smoothly in our democratic system. We therefore have accomplished very little, and it's high time we looked for an alternative. A decade ago, when our IT companies like Infosys, Wipro, TCS, etc. were surging ahead, a foreign journalist inquired of the then Prime Minister
as to what the government did to make this happen. His reply is supposed to be, we politicians haven't really understood that industry yet. The recent assembly election results are quite interesting. So far as the quest for change that people have evinced, we are now seeing entrepreneurship in politics too. The message on the wall is that people want reforms, and reforms take entrepreneurship one step ahead too. Once entrepreneurship takes off in full gear, so does the economy. On a recent visit to a motor museum in a small town in the UK, I was fascinated to see children in small groups of five, guided by their teachers, drawing exhibits on their workbook. Not all were promising artists of the future. Neither did they aspire to be one. The way their imagination captured those exhibits, it is certain that creativity and inventiveness exude in all of them. The situation was no different at the Science Museum at London either. These children were only in the third and fourth standard. So, you know where it all begins. The Rotman School of Management in Canada opened a venture lab, allowing students and with innovative ideas from the university to commercialize them, to start businesses with them using leading-edge technologies. Such initiatives are necessary and should be expanded across other institutions, geographies, and industries. Last year, our CM announced a very noble initiative, awarding class attendance to student entrepreneurs. Definitely, it was one of the most welcome actions. For decades now, we have had similar initiatives for sportsmen and artists among students. Though it was a great motivation, it has actually added very few bright stars in those arenas. Therefore, we need to come up with other initiatives too, to help budding entrepreneurs establish themselves. We definitely need more affirmative actions and government initiatives to build our overall infrastructure. All the leading economies of the world have moved on various levels of compliance for entrepreneurs and are now reaping its benefits. In Kerala, we have a very proactive chief minister who thinks ahead of his times and takes keen interest in promoting innovation and entrepreneurship in the state. But a direct interference from him is not always practical and long-lasting, so we need to put in place a sustainable mechanism. Opting for this mode does not imply that it will be trouble-free. Issues will most certainly come up, but at least an entrepreneur knows exactly where the issue lies, so he can put his money, as the saying goes, where his mouth is. Wouldn't you agree? Infrastructure is the key word today. While world-class infrastructure, especially road infra network and vehicle density, is a hallmark of development in all developed nations, we have a long way ahead to reckon ourselves among them. The World Bank's development indices have now some interesting statistics in regard to the vehicle density per 1,000 people. Advanced countries like Sweden and Finland, which are more socialistic in their governance than the so-called socialist countries, have a massive 600 vehicles per 1,000 people. Japan, a highly densely populated country, too has 600 vehicles per 1,000 people. Singapore, where a 3 lakh car in India would cost 30 lakhs, also has 154 vehicles per 1,000 people. Coming to India, we have a merely 18 vehicles per 1,000 people. Kerala fares slightly better with 28 to 30 vehicles. 5 years ago when India was 10, Malaysia was 50. Today, we are at 18 and Malaysia is 350 per 1,000 people. It is almost 7 times. This was facilitated by only because of their infrastructure. We cannot go back on our infrastructure development, citing higher population as a reason. Even our war-torn neighbors, Afghanistan and Sri Lanka, have 28 and 48 vehicles per 1,000 people, respectively. A city like Tokyo has 4 or 5 levels of roads besides its 5 or 6 levels of underground metro. To quote Jack Welch, if we don't take control of our destiny, someone else will. Our people may in the future migrate for better living conditions instead of in search of jobs that are happening now. It is not just the road infrastructure that matters, but the overall infrastructure that aids trade, commerce, and economic development. The state of California has planned to give free Wi-Fi connectivity to all its residents. That's thinking ahead. It may reduce traffic density too, at the same time increase commerce. There is no substitute for infrastructure and no substitute for the government's responsibility in developing it. The government can run a welfare state only if it is linked to productivity. Creating jobs just for the sake of people's welfare and funding it cannot be sustained unless it is rendered productive. As the Japanese saying goes, you give a man a fish, he'll eat his dinner today. If you teach him how to fish, he'll eat his dinner every day. So, modern governments need to be enablers, enabling the youth to dream big and rendering all assistance to them in transforming their dreams into reality. This year, our theme is prosperity for entrepreneurship. There may be concern about the relevance of entrepreneurship when the country is generally weak and businesses are going through a slump. But according to the UN study, entrepreneurships sustain even in bad times. Unlike the old days, the stigma among society, especially parents, against starting new ventures has come down drastically. Today's generation has a mindset more conducive for risk taking, and success stories of new startups with out-of-the-box thinking are aplenty. The cost of overcoming entry barriers to set up businesses meaningfully has never been lower. You can set up and operate a business from a laptop or even a cell phone. You can set up a virtual office with cloud computing. You have access to research and information about your market and competitors. You can host a global conference calls with web meetings and basic technology. Most importantly, you can reach customers worldwide on the internet to sell your products and services. You can even seek startup capital and online funding. In other words, you can enter an industry, operate like a bigger player, and grow a business globally faster, cheaper, and more effectively than ever before. Traditionally, Malayalis have never shied away from entrepreneurship, but we need to revive that spirit as a mass movement. Going by our mission, having an entrepreneur in every home, our attempt in this year's TaiCon is to showcase the Malayali entrepreneur to the world. For Kerala to realize our dream of prosperity through entrepreneurship, this is imperative. Let us use this platform to identify our potential and to transform our creativity into successful models of enterprise that are self-sustaining and the engines of economic prosperity. If music be the food of love, play on, wrote Shakespeare. If entrepreneurship be the food of prosperity, let's play on. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your determination to make a difference. Our next speaker, Sri Ashok Rao, is the chairman of Thai Global. Mr. Ashok Rao is a senior serial entrepreneur with five successful high technology startups behind him. He took one of them, Midcom Communications, public with a market cap in excess of $400 million. In fact, he was one of the first Indian Americans to take a company public on NASDAQ. Mr. Rao is an angel investor in six high-tech startups. He serves on the board of several public and private companies and institutions like Jones Business School of Rice University. Mr. Rao has a BS in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Delhi, MS from Marquette University, and Executive Diploma in Financial Management from the London School of Economics. His vast experience, illustrious career, and ability to make a difference makes him the apt person to present the next address, Power of One. Can one person with the right amount of vision, inspiration, and drive really make a difference? Well, let us hear it from the man himself, Mr. Ashok Rao.
Thank you, Shruti. Honorable Chief Minister, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. On behalf of Thai's 15,000 members, and we'll get the statistics right because we've heard a variety of statistics this morning. On behalf of Thai's 15,000 members in 61 cities and 18 countries, it is a real pleasure and privilege to be once here again at Taikon Kerala for the second year in a row. In this most beautiful state that boasts the highest literacy, the highest life expectancy, and the lowest corruption of any state in India. Chief Minister, you're to be congratulated. I got his attention. First of all, a big hand to Thai Kerala President John Paul and his entire team for pulling off this great conference. Probably the largest gathering of entrepreneurs in South India on a regular annual basis. Last year at this conference, I spoke about innovation and entrepreneurship and how important they were for the economic health of this state and our nation. I also requested Honorable Chief Minister to look at setting up a ministry specifically dedicated to entrepreneurship. If any state can do it with enlightened leadership that sets an example to the rest of the nation, it's probably Kerala. Because the sad fact is that India is not a very business-friendly country. Now, before you patriots in your audience get upset at me for being anti-India, this is not my opinion. This is the factual finding of the World Bank, which conducts its annual survey of 185 countries in a study called Doing Business. It ranks countries from 1 to 185 in the ease of doing business by looking at a variety of factors such as obtaining permits, getting electricity, protecting investors, protecting intellectual property, resolving bankruptcy, the rule of law, and a host of other relevant categories. India, in spite of its tremendous economic success, ranks a dismal 134th, yes, 134th in the world out of the 185 countries analyzed. Due to almost all the problems I enumerated earlier, the more depressing stat is the fact that since last year's study, we've slipped 2 spots. We were 132nd last year, we're 134th this year. And even worse is we rank 173rd in the world in the difficulty of starting a business and 184th, almost dead last, in the ability to enforce contracts. Certainly, India's had an enviable record of economic growth and success over the past 2 decades. One could say, incredible India is shining by all accounts. But like many countries, India is saddled with a mind-numbing variety of arcane regulations that make it very difficult to start and operate a business. Additionally, our courts take forever to address wrongdoings, contractual defaults, and endemic corruption is pervasive in almost all facets of our lives. The sad conclusion? Indian entrepreneurs are succeeding in spite of their government. But succeeding they are. Indian entrepreneurs are succeeding with vision, grit, perseverance, innovative methods of getting over hurdles, and most importantly, an unshakable self-belief in their ability to inspire and lead their teams to success. So a big hand for the Indian entrepreneurs. I do love this audience. They clap on cue. History is crowded with examples of such individuals, people who so believed in their visions and ideas that they were able to inspire and lead others and accomplish extraordinary things. In world affairs, we, of course, have examples like Mahatma Gandhi, Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King, the late Nelson Mandela, Mikhail Gorbachev, amongst others. They had the gift of great vision, inspired millions, galvanized them across all facets of their lives around a cause, accomplished the impossible, and changed the world for the better. Even Hitler or Osama bin Laden could be said to fall into that category of leaders who inspired millions with the power of one, though sadly for all the wrong reasons and not for the betterment of this world. Mahatma Gandhi didn't just free India, he ended colonialism. Abraham Lincoln ended the obscenity of slavery. Martin Luther King continued Lincoln's work, his journey, with civil rights. The late Nelson Mandela ended apartheid in South Africa, and Mikhail Gorbachev brought down the Iron Curtain, freeing half of Europe and ending the Cold War. These people, of course, were unique, charismatic, extraordinary political figures. They changed the world, impacting millions and millions. But broadly speaking, when it comes to altering our daily lives, the great scientists, doctors, inventors, and entrepreneurs of the world of history have been far more influential than political figures. But it's highly unlikely that any one of us in this room, perhaps other than Bernard, can ever aspire to be like them. But using them as role models and studying how they lived and how they inspired others around them, in our own smaller way, we can also try to change the world. Think about it. Throughout the ages, individuals with this unshakable belief in the power of one have impacted our world. In the 19th century, let's not go too far back, you saw the example of the matchstick in 1827 from Mr. John Walker. Such men and women, legends that we make movies about, ignited the Industrial Revolution, game changers such as Thomas Edison. A prolific inventor, he didn't just invent. He started 14 companies, including General Electric and Commonwealth Edison. In fact, very few people don't. He gave the world the electric light bulb, the phonograph, talking motion pictures, and 1,300 other inventions. As a combination of inventive genius and entrepreneurial flair, he is the one. I think we need the house lights on, because I do need to look at my audience. Folks, house lights up, please. Nobody listens to my cues anymore. Well, think about some other people who impacted the world during that time. Alexander Graham Bell, endowed with genuine intellectual curiosity, invented the telephone in 1876 at the age of 29. Then he went on to form the Bell Telephone Company, which ended up becoming one of the largest corporations in the entire world, AT&T. The remarkable Henry Ford, without whom John Paul might not have a business today, single-handedly brought the motor car to the masses with his Model T Ford a little over 100 years ago. But the more profound impact he had was on manufacturing. The moving assembly line that he designed to build his cars was probably the most important breakthrough of the Industrial Revolution. Starting small, these entrepreneurs of the 19th century pursued their vision. I don't have vision.
Pardon, power failure.
Why do we rank 134th? Getting electricity becomes a problem. Well, anyway, as I was saying, starting small, facing a lot of obstacles, they achieved, changed our lives, changed the world. The same thing happened in the 20th century with some incredible entrepreneurs, led a huge renaissance. Legends in their own time. People like Steve Jobs. 30 years ago, he invents a user-friendly computer for the masses, so wonderfully intuitive that even geeks and technophobes embrace it. He gets kicked out of his own company, he comes back and reinvents mobile phones, music, and media. It's been said the world has been influenced by three apples. The first was the apple Eve ate, Eve of Adam and Eve fame. The second was the apple that fell on Isaac Newton's head and changed the laws of physics. And the third was the apple given to us by Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, the legend, the magician, the innovator, the one. He recently bade goodbye to this world, but he left it in a very changed and improved state than the one he entered. Let's talk about Robert Noyce. Everybody familiar with Robert Noyce? Bob Noyce invented the microchip in 1959, heralding a revolution in miniaturization and computing. Changed our world. He founded Intel in 1968, today the world's largest manufacturer of semiconductors. And its chips gave rise to the term Silicon Valley. And then there is my own favorite from the 20th century, Ted Turner. He changed television news with CNN, which arguably helped bring down the Iron Curtain and helped him win Time Magazine's 1991 Man of the Year Award. He also changed philanthropy by giving away $1 billion to the UN 15 years ago, which inspired Bill Gates and Warren Buffett to do the same. It made giving fashionable to the super rich. And he got to marry Jane Fonda. And now at the age of 75, he's saving the endangered bison by breeding them on his 15 ranches all across the United States. And you think about people with the power of one in the 21st century, and we've had plenty of them. Think about Larry Page and Sergey Brin. Not very often does your company become a verb in the dictionary. Don't believe me? Just Google it. Their mission to organize the world's information has affected almost everybody in the entire world. Think Mark Zuckerberg, Time Magazine's Man of the Year in 2010, created social media with Facebook. Think Jack Dorsey. While an undergrad at NYU, he created Twitter. Today, with 600 million users posting 400 million tweets per day and 2 billion queries per day, the world without Twitter is unimaginable. Then there's Elon Musk, my favorite, serial entrepreneur, founder of PayPal, Tesla, and SpaceX. He changed the way we pay our bills. He's now changing the automotive industry with 2012's Car of the Year. And like Richard Branson and Jeff Bezos, has set his sights firmly on commercial space travel becoming a reality in our own lifetime. So this list of people with the power of one is very long, and we can all rattle them off. We can all rattle off our personal favorites. Some fail, some succeed, some excel. And those who excel change the world. So here, without much further ado, is a couple of examples of my personal favorites, all endowed with the power of one, and their journeys are worth learning from. Let's start with Sir Alexander Fleming. Alexander Fleming's discovery of penicillin took 14 years. He started in 1914 during World War I when he was a battlefield doctor right there on the battlefront in France. And he realized that many soldiers were dying of sepsis. Sepsis is deep infection. Even though lots of antiseptics were being used by the field doctors. And he discovered that these antiseptics worked well on the surface but could not penetrate deep inside the wound where the infection existed. Unfortunately, most army physicians were skeptical about what he was talking about, so they continued to use antiseptics and killed a lot of soldiers while treating them. It took Fleming 14 years, but his discovery of penicillin was almost an accident. He wrote in his diary, "When I woke up that morning in September 1928, I certainly didn't plan to revolutionize all of medicine by discovering the world's first antibiotic. But I guess I did." By 1928, Fleming had spent 14 years trying to find this bacteria killer, so he took a month's vacation. He stacked all his bacteria cultures in the corner of his lab, and when he returned, he found that one of them had developed a fungus, and the bacteria surrounding this fungus had died, whereas the cultures that had been set a little further away were still alive and thriving. He grew this mold, he grew this fungus, and found that it killed bacteria. So he isolated, and after months of calling it mold juice, he renamed it penicillin in March of 1929 and changed medicine forever. Interesting journey of a man with the power of one. Jonas Salk is another one that truly demonstrated the power of one. Most of you are way too young to know this, but till 1955, and some of us are not that young, I can see in the audience, till 1955, it was polio, not malaria, not smallpox, that was the most frightening public health problem in the world. The 1952 epidemic in the United States had 60,000 cases reported, 4,000 deaths, and 25,000 paralyzed, mostly children. President Harry Truman is reported to have said, "America is afraid from apart from the atomic bomb, America's greatest fear is polio." So he started his quest in 1947, it took him 8 years, and the historians say this, that the field trial that he developed for his vaccine was the most elaborate program of its kind, involving 20,000 physicians, 64,000 volunteers, 64,000 school personnel, excuse me, and 250,000 volunteers with 2 million school children taking part. The vaccine succeeded. Salk was hailed as a miracle worker and was asked in an interview whether he owned the patent to the vaccine. Salk replied, "There is no patent. Can you patent the sun?" Let's have a little change of pace. I'm sure many of you have seen the movie Bugsy. How many of you have seen the movie Bugsy starring Warren Beatty? Well, it's about a notorious gangster called Benjamin Siegel, known as Bugsy to his friends. But he was endowed with the power of one, the gift of vision. He single-handedly invented Las Vegas, building a gambling mecca in the middle of a Nevada desert. Only he saw that a town like that could become an oasis, lush oasis of pleasure, where gambling is one of the attractions. So in 1945, he moved to Las Vegas, population 8,000. built his casino called the Flamingo, and today there are 75 casinos and a population of 2 million in Las Vegas, all because of Bugsy. Unfortunately, he was gunned down in 1947 by his fellow gangsters. But give the devil his due, before there was the Bellagio, there was Bugsy. So when we think about all of this, we come to this conclusion that you don't have to be on the fast track to billionaire status to learn something from each of these people. If there's one common theme, it's this: they have vision, passion for what they do, and a real commitment to seeing it through. They all have great imagination, enthusiasm, integrity, and empowered and inspired their people around them. But that package is a tall order. Not everybody has it. But we can, by studying their lives, figure out what are the key ingredients that made them successful. And I have come up with what I think are the 10 key ingredients. You can all argue that these are the 10. You might have your own flavor. But here they are. Number one, they articulated a compelling vision. Helen Keller, the famous blind lady, when she was asked, "Is there anything worse than being blind?" answered, "Yes, there is. The most pathetic person in the whole world is someone who has sight but has no vision." Nothing extraordinary ever happened without a leader articulating a bold vision, a course of action. We've seen this throughout history. Think about John F. Kennedy challenging the U.S. to land a man on the moon, put a man in space by the end of the decade. Number two, they ignited enthusiasm. Inspirational leadership is all about turning a dream or vision into reality with and through the cooperation of other people. Number three, they painted a picture for the future. They invited participation. Our brains are programmed more for stories than for abstract ideas. Gandhi, Lincoln, Mandela, JFK, even Hitler, all of them were storytellers. Jonas Salk was a storyteller. He could not have galvanized 2 million people to help cure polio without the ability to tell a story. They were relentlessly optimistic. The ability to act with grace and dignity under fire when things get tough is the hallmark of optimistic people. But be a realistic optimist. Whatever you do, don't underestimate how difficult it might be, because if you think it's effortless and easy, you've got another think coming. These leaders also exemplified perseverance and grit. Just think about Alexander Fleming. It took him 14 years to discover penicillin. They knew their strengths. We lead on the basis of our strengths. We build teams on the basis of their strengths. So the number one rule in business is get the best person for the job. Rule number two, delegate. Rule number three, don't delegate success. By that I mean make sure you supervise the people that you have delegated to. The great ones, this is my characteristic number seven. The great ones focused on getting better rather than simply being good. Because our skills are malleable. We can improve with time. We can improve with effort. We can improve with passion. They stayed intellectually curious, and they earned the respect they got by walking their talk. When you conduct yourself with integrity and model the traits you want to see in others, you get the respect of those around you. Demanding respect just because of your position or title will not get you very far. And finally, number 10, they were willing to stand alone. If you have a passion, dream, or mission, you will find that sometimes you may have to work alone. You'll probably be lonely. People will follow you for a while. However, when things get tough, when pleasure and comfort compete with responsibility and long hours, some followers may drop off. And this is when you have to stick to your goal and be prepared to stand alone. Remember, there's a famous quote, and I forget who said it. They say as you get older, memory is the second thing that goes. I forgot what the first was. But the famous quote is, "A person who wants to lead the orchestra needs to turn his back to the crowd." So as Steve Jobs said, your time is limited. Don't waste it living someone else's life. Don't be trapped by dogma, living the results of other people's thinking. Don't let the noise of other opinions drown out your own inner voice. And most importantly, have the courage to follow your own intuition. So to sort of put a wrap on this power of one, which is kind of a difficult topic, right? I wrote a poem that I think might help put it all together. and I call it. That one is you. So here goes. Do you feel sometimes lost and nameless, like one raindrop in deep ocean's blue? A snowflake on mountains majestic, fleeting vapor from morning dew. A whisper hushed by competing voices, a haunting note in melody sung. Yes, we're part of a wondrous family, yet still defined by the power of one. One tree can start a forest, one flower can awaken a dream. One song can spark a moment, one bird can herald spring. One smile begins a friendship, one laugh will conquer gloom. One candle destroys the darkness, one sunbeam lights a room. One breath brings life internal, one path will lead you there. One step must start each journey, one touch can show you care. One word must start each prayer, one voice can speak with wisdom. Stay the course, light a star, change the world wherever you are. One person can make a difference, and that one is you. Thank you.
Wow, a poet too. I should add that to the list next time. But it's always a joy listening to you, Mr. Rao. Thank you for inspiring us with stories from history and also then giving us mantras to follow. Thank you so much again. Now it's time for the inaugural address. We have our Honorable Chief Minister, Sri Umman Chandy, who has been relentlessly pursuing various developmental initiatives for the state. An ardent supporter and evangelist of entrepreneurship, Mr. Umman Chandy has been instrumental in bringing together business leaders to foster growth through various initiatives, including Emerging Kerala and his support of Thai Kerala. We are proud that he's here with us at ThaiCon, second year in a row. Sir, we are honored to have you here today. I welcome you to deliver the inaugural address.
President of the meeting, Sri John K. Paul, Sri Ashok Rao, Chairman Thai Global, Dr. Bernard R. Harris, Sri P. H. Kurian, Dr. M. Srinath Shastri, Sri A. V. George, Sri S. R. Nair, distinguished delegates and friends. I am happy to be here amongst all of you who have come from various parts of the world to participate in ThaiCon 2013, a gathering of some of the most influential change agents on this planet. Entrepreneurs are change agents in the society. They generate knowledge, employment, and wealth in the society. On behalf of the people of Kerala, I extend my warm welcome to all of you. There is so much in common between politicians and startup entrepreneurs. We are leaders, storytellers, and work with passion in our respective areas. We burn our midnight oil to run the nation, while startups burn midnight oil to run their companies. Today, being amongst all of you, I want to share four stories and lessons from my life and also share my excitement in the entrepreneurial search that is sweeping Kerala. The first story is about having passion in life. When I was young and a student entering into politics, there was a burning desire to be a change agent in the society. It is like the fire in the belly of an entrepreneur which keeps one going to challenge the status quo. Even today, it is that fire in my belly that keeps me going with the same enthusiasm and vigor when I first stood for elections. The success of any entrepreneur is also the same fire in the belly which is otherwise known as passion. How passion for whatever you are doing, and then you will succeed in life. The second story is about making mistakes. When I entered the political arena, I was young and in college. The real world learning was at its maximum, and I made a lot of mistakes as we were doing many things for the first time. It is okay to make mistakes. Luckily, there was no internet or social media then to amplify any mistake to out of size proportions, and this gave us ample opportunities to learn from the mistakes and not to repeat the same mistakes again. Make all your mistakes early in life and learn from them when you are young. When you get older, mistakes become costly, and it's true for a life both in business as well as politics. My third story is about fear of failure. The most successful politicians are the ones who conquer the fear of failure. We politicians are not afraid of failure. We never had anyone quit a political career because we lost an election. Instead, we always came back and fight to win again. I encourage the young startups never to be afraid of failure. You only fail when you give up. So, never give up. The fourth story is about personal integrity and self-belief in truth. We believe in a world where there are revolutions happening everywhere, from Egypt to Turkey to Brazil. Here at home, too, there was a stage-managed revolution, and these are testing times in our lives. I drew energy for inner strength and courage from the people who believed in me. Personal integrity and the self-belief in truth are key values for any entrepreneur. Always be honest and truthful to yourself, and that alone will give you the courage and conviction to stand fearless and conquer any adversity in life, whether in politics or in business. I hope that these lessons, which I learned from my life's experiences, are always useful to you in your journey as an entrepreneur. I am eager to share my excitement that for the first time in the history of our state, we are becoming truly entrepreneurial at home. It is exciting to see the young technology startups trying hard to make a change in the world being based in Kerala. The youth of today are global citizens being born in a world with internet and smartphones. The government of Kerala is committed to our startups. The best policies, the best tools, and the best-in-class infrastructure. I believe that the technology, especially the internet, is a great equalizer in the society. If internet was given to all homes in the country, the only state where possibly everyone can use it is Kerala, with its 100% literacy. With massively open online courses like Coursera, our students can now learn from the best of global universities like Stanford, Harvard, or MIT. We are working on how to integrate these online classrooms to the real world classrooms. And once we do that, our quality of education would take a giant leap to international standards. Every startup works on momentum, and I believe that Kerala has the highest momentum in the country in the product startup world. It was only in March 15, 2012, that I announced in New Delhi that we are going to launch Startup Village, the first public-private partnership model incubator in the country, along with the Government of India, Technopark, and the private sector. That was a big catalyst to create a product startup ecosystem in our state. As many young students came forward to fulfill the dream of a Silicon Coast. Encouraged by the motivation of our youth, on September 12, 2012, at Emerging Kerala, the state announced the historic student entrepreneurship policy for the first time in the country, where young college students would be given 20% attendance and 4% grace marks for trying to create a startup. I am happy to let you know that since then, over 500 students have come forward to start technology startups, which again is the highest in India. Let me remind you that when Apple launched the App Store, it was again with around 500 apps. And today, there are over 1 million apps in the Apple Store. The App Store changed the world, and believe that the youth of Kerala is on its way to change the world. Today, there are over 1,400 product startups in Startup Village alone, which is again the highest in the country for any incubator. The momentum is clearly shifting to Kerala to be the startup capital of the country. Change is the only constant in business today. The world around me, since I was a young college student who dreamed to make a positive change in the society, I am seeing my roles transform from that young college change agent to empowering other change agents who are now ready to challenge the status quo in the world. I am inclined to believe that the same change that is happening to me would be happening in your lives as well, whereas young entrepreneurs, you were setting out to change the world. And now, as we get older, we have to change our roles in mentoring some of the most brilliant young startups out there. We cannot take our wealth or knowledge to the grave. And I hope all of you have come with an attitude to open your checkbooks and invest in the young startups around you. I encourage you to be angel investors to startups who are unheard but fearless. They need your support now more than ever before. Global companies like Google, Facebook, or Twitter were founded by young startups that had the first checks from angel investors. I want to promise you that the government of Kerala would be the largest angel investor in the country to our young startups and would back them. That would back them like any investor to the fullest extent possible to create disruptive global startups from our homeland. We have had successful entrepreneurs in the past. To name a few, Western India, Sri Khadar Kutty, Sindhat, Sri C.V. Jacob, Eastern, Sri Miran, Sri Lina Krishnan Nayar, Sri MKK Nayar, Sri KPP Nambiar, Sri KP Hormis, Sri V. Kurian, Sri MS Aminadan, and about a decade ago, several IT entrepreneurs. We are happy to inform the audience that for the first time in India, the government of Kerala has earmarked 1% of the state budget for young entrepreneurs. This amount comes to over 500 crore annually and will be invested to provide a world-class ecosystem for our startups at home, including angel funding. Disruptive startups are changing the way the world works, and sometimes I wonder why these startups are mostly born in Silicon Valley. People who have visited the valley tell me that it is about the startup culture in Silicon Valley. We want to learn more about this culture. As I speak here today, 5 of Kerala's most talented youngsters are currently visiting Silicon Valley and meeting some of the brightest minds out there and learning about this culture. TAI is a global organization, and with its strong roots in Silicon Valley, I would like to extend the support of the state government to build a bridge between Cochin and California. We want to benchmark ourselves with the best in the technology world and join hands with all of you to cement this global partnership to learn about the startup culture on angel investing and help in setting up a landing pad for our startups in Silicon Valley. When you leave after TAIKON 2013, I want you to carry an image of Kerala as a lean startup which is trying hard and experimenting to kickstart the entrepreneurial culture. We are happy to pivot continuously till we find the right winning strategy. I am convinced that the stage is set for a global startup revolution from Kerala, and I am happy to welcome all of you to be part of this revolution. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your reassuring, supportive, and inspiring words. We applaud you for all your initiatives in the area of entrepreneurship. We are honored to have with us Dr. Bernard A. Harris Jr., who is currently the CEO and managing partner of Vesalius Ventures Incorporated, a venture capital firm that invests in early to mid-stage healthcare technologies and companies. Prior to his entrepreneurial and business experience of over 20 years, Dr. Harris was at NASA for 10 years, where he conducted clinical investigations of space adaptation and developed in-flight medical devices to extend astronaut stays in space. Selected into the astronaut corps in January 1990, Dr. Harris was the first African-American to walk in space. A veteran astronaut of over 20 years, he has logged more than 438 hours and traveled over 7.2 million miles in space. Dr. Harris is also the founder of the Harris Foundation, a nonprofit organization that supports math, science education, and crime prevention programs for America's youth. I kindly request Dr. Harris to share a few words with us.
Well, good morning. It is certainly wonderful to be here in Kerala, and I know the minister had to leave, but certainly I was glad to hear all the effort that he has spearheaded and bringing high tech and entrepreneurship here in this great state. I want to also say thank you to Ashok, who had the wisdom to invite me to Greece to the Global TAI Initiative, where I was really honored and embraced by the group that was there. It was wonderful. And John Paul, thank you for the invitation. Now, one thing that people don't know here is that John Paul and his contingent of Kerala actually adopted my life partner, Valerie, who is standing in the red dress taking pictures of everyone here. Hey, honey. Wave to the crowd there. And it was wonderful because we felt like we had met new friends. We felt like we were part of the family as we toured around Greece and the Acropolis and had a wonderful time and got the invitation to come here, which, of course, we couldn't say no. So I'm very pleased to be here. One of my favorite quotes is by philosopher Emmett Fox, who says that your heart's desire is the voice of God, and then goes on to say that that voice must be obeyed sooner or later. Today, as we start this Thai conference here in Kerala, we celebrate the voice of all of you. By being here, you are expressing your voice. You are delineating your dream, and I'm glad to be a part of it. You are here to fulfill your dreams of building wealth. You're here to discover your innate talents and to share those talents with others. And more importantly, by sharing those talents and sharing those dreams, you are giving back to the world. And today I'm glad to be a part of that. So thank you very much for the invitation. I look forward to meeting all of you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. I'm looking forward to your keynote address tomorrow. Next, I'd like to request P.H. Kurian, IAS, who is currently the Principal Secretary, Department of Information Technology, Government of Kerala, to share a few words with us. An Administrator Par Excellence, Mr. Kurian has served in various capacities and positions over his tenure with the government, from Managing Director of various PSUs to Director of Industries and Commerce to Secretary of Industries. He has initiated and established various reforms and initiatives like the Nirmal 2000 or e-governance. Mr. Kurian was selected as one in 50 most influential global personalities in the field of intellectual property consecutively for 2 years, 2009 and 2010, by the global magazine iManaging Patent. This is a unique distinction for an Indian. I request Mr. Kurian to share a few words with us, sir.
The president of Thai Kerala chapter, Sri John Paul, Ashok Rao, Dr. Bernard Harris, Ashar Nair, Shastri, my very old friend A.V. George, ladies and gentlemen. Let me congratulate John Paul and his team of charter members who have taken great efforts to organize this event for the second time, and I believe that this will be an annual affair in future to go. And I also believe that in last 1 year, between ThaiCon 2012 and ThaiCon 2013, a lot of things happened in Kerala, as explained here by the CM. Before ThaiCon itself, in Kerala, under the leadership of Sri Umman Chandy, a lot of efforts, a lot of announcements, a lot of programs were started. And ThaiCon 2012, Emerging Kerala 2012, before that, were all fora in which a lot of inputs have come to the government, and we acted upon that. I don't think I can make a comparison as a bureaucrat like what the CM said. Politicians and entrepreneurs are similar. I believe I'm 100% agree with all of you. I'm sure you will agree that bureaucrats are no match for entrepreneurs. Bureaucrats believe to create hurdles in the way of entrepreneurs because of the regulations that they enforce. And most of them are not their creations. They are creation by society. They are creation by politicians. So I believe that all the bureaucrats are out to create hurdles. But we have created systems When Mr. Ashok Rao was saying that we are 164 or 174 in difficulty in doing business and 132 slipped to 134 in ease of doing business. I am also a great follower of that. Every year I read that report of the World Bank ease of doing business. They do a similar report for various states, comparing states in India. Always our state doesn't stand very much in the front, but we are not behind as well. Like Mr. Umanjandi said about a politician, I joined as a bureaucrat. One thing I had to say at that time, you cannot change the world, you cannot do anything like a politician, but you can also contribute little by making the life of people easy, by taking away as much as I can from the clutches of bureaucratic stranglehold. And last 28 years I've been doing that. I have been doing that in Kerala. I was doing that in Orissa when I was spent around 7 years' time. And I'll continue to do so. And I got an opportunity again to work by reducing those hurdles or removing some of those hurdles from the entrepreneurs. I don't want to take time, but I want to just give an example which day before yesterday, in a meeting chaired by CM, I saw how bureaucratic hurdles comes. And we resolved there to remove it. We have amended the land reform law, allowing the plantations to set apart 5% of their land to have tourism, agriculture, medicinal plants, vegetable cultivars, or something like that. Unfortunately, last year, the government has brought in a guideline which is nothing but hurdles, which is against the spirit of that legislation. Legislation was done by the assembly, got an assent from the president. Day before yesterday, when it was read out, I was one person in the presence of CM and three, four other ministers objected to such a regulation which is unnecessary. That shows the way we actually sometimes go back. And we resolved on that day to change it. One of them is as an entrepreneur, as a plantation owner, like A.V. George or his company or some a few others sitting here, want to actually do agriculture out of their 5% land, they have to take a permission from the agriculture department. If they want to do tourism center, they do take a permission from the tourism department, which otherwise is not required. For somebody to start a hotel or a restaurant, doesn't require a tourism department permission. A lot of things have been included, and we are going to change that. The same way, the bureaucracy in Kerala, each time when we see this, such hurdles have been created, and then one need to change that. I saw another example which last one week I'm doing is, you know, these are all hurdle in front of entrepreneurs. Government of India notified ordinary earth as a minor mineral. Their minor mineral definition in the law is ordinary earth used for filling or leveling roads, railways, and major construction of buildings. And in our state, they made a rule considering ordinary earth as a mineral, which has made the life of a hell. I'm a farmer's son. I now sort of administer that rule. I'm the head of the department which administer that rule. When you go by that rule, I am a farmer's son. I feel that if I do some farming in my land, that amounts to mining. That's the type of rule we have made. Last 1 month, I am trying to change that rule, which really make the rule with consonants with the Government of India notification. It's very difficult. It's a very difficult proposal. It's much more difficult than an entrepreneur to change the rules, to change these regulations, to make it entrepreneur friendly. But I can tell you, and I will try to do as much as I can. Last 1 year, with the startup village starting, we got a lot of opportunity to actually work with them, work with the Thai to bring in more and more entrepreneurship, entrepreneur-friendly, startup-friendly policies, budgeting, schemes, and things like that. Great ideas have been given by these young startups, which most of it the Chief Minister accepted, and we are on the way to do it. One of the most important things which I want to announce here, I think the CM unfortunately did not mention that we are going to set up Fab Labs in two of the startup locations, and in 19 engineering colleges with MIT. These are all big push for the youngsters to come into technology-based entrepreneurship. Or the other biggest program, which is almost equal to what UK as a country does, this small state has announced and is doing next month is, we are going to give 10,000 Raspberry Pi every year to college students, school students, of high school students. That will again spur their innovative spirit by working with Raspberry Pi. These are the two big programs which already government has announced this will happen in 2014. 2014, the Raspberry Pi will be distributed twice, one in next month or February, and one in around September next year. So every year we have now budgeted for that 10,000 Raspberry Pi for the school students. And then we also set up that big technology innovation zone in Cochin. I don't want to say anything. Whatever is possible, whatever better suggestions come from young entrepreneurs, the government of Mr. Munchandi is ready to accept this. And with a lot of push from these young entrepreneurs, the government has decided to set apart that 1% of the budget, which is a big money. And next year, I don't know, 1% will not come, but maybe over a period of 3-4 years, that 1% might come, which will be a great fillip to help you all. That's what I want to say. We are here. I am as a person to committed to help you all, and I will do that. Once again, congratulations, John Paul. Let's do it together. I remember last moment, there was one guy who was sitting there, Josh Dominic, sometime in 2002 or 3. He spread this thing. I think when the TIE started first year in 2004, Kerala can, we can, or some such words. And those things I was thinking where we are going to do this in 10 years' time. A lot of things has happened, Josh. You know, you started on that day. This is really is taking shape, and I as a person is very happy. I am a very concerned person of Kerala. Believe that this is possible, and we can have it together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words and infectious enthusiasm. Thank you again. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. M. Srinatha Shastri, Chief General Manager of State Bank of India. Dr. Shastri joined SBI in 1983. He has had a spectacular rise to his current role after stints in risk management and general management. Dr. Shastri has a PhD in physics. He's also a chartered financial analyst and a financial risk manager. Sir, would you please share a few words with us?
So good morning, everybody. John Kipal, President, TIE Kerala. Ashok Rao, Chairman, TIE Global. Dr. Bernard A. Harris, Jr., P.H. Kurian, Mr. A.V. George, Mr. S.R. Nair, all delegates and budding entrepreneurs. We from State Bank of India are very proud to be part of this event. This all started 4-5 months ago when a team from TIE Kerala, led by Mr. Matthews and other key members of this, met me. They wanted me to be the sponsor of this event. I had absolutely no doubt about saying yes to that for two reasons. One, they're all the leading entrepreneurs in the state, and all of them are banking with us, so we feel really proud of that. The second one is more important to me, the sincerity and the passion with which they were doing that one. And they have got their own big business, and the business grows, that demands more time of themselves. And if they can spend that time on their own venture, they grow faster. But they chose to share that time with others. They were not seeking anything for themselves. They were trying to do something for the society. So that made me to say yes several times, and I try to make this happen to this one. And three words here, the link, learn, and lead. When I was sitting there and looking at it, it has a different meaning because normally linking in this context, the junior entrepreneurs try to link with the seniors. Here, the seniors with open heart inviting you to join them and share that one. Next one is learn. Knowledge comes from experience. Experience comes from failure. And wise people learn from other failures. But here are the set of people who are ready to share their learning and their failures, what they have learned, so that you need not start from the ground, but you can start at the higher level, and you will have your own learnings, but they are ready to share with you. So you have that advantage. Leaders, that is there for you to see. They have made this event possible, And I think they need a big round of applause for making this possible. Entire team, Thai Kerala. I wanted to, we were given as sponsors, no, few passes were given. So I thought of sharing this with our existing customers all over Kerala. They have been distributed. Some of them have come. But I was really impressed when I came to know in the morning that some of them have chosen to send their next generation children. Means they have realized the importance of this one and listening to the various speakers, and means Thai Kerala has made its presence felt in Kerala. Again, I think they deserve well a good round of applause. From State Bank of India, I assure that we will be with you for all viable ventures to support from the banking services. And with these few words, I pray to God to give all success to entrepreneurship in Kerala. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And thank you for State Bank of India's support for this cause. Thai Kerala had already announced its angel fund to help startup entrepreneurs. We take this opportunity to officially launch it today. I request Thai Global Chairman, Sri Ashok Rao, to hand over the seed fund check of rupees 3.5 lakhs to Mr. Abhinav Shree of Spring R. I would request Sri Abhinav Shree to come forward and collect it from him. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, sir, and thank you, Abhinav. As a token of our love and appreciation, I request Sri N.R. Panikkar, Chairman of Thaicon 2013, to present a memento to Sri Ashok Rao. I request Sri A.V. George to present a memento to P.H. Kurian. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. I request Sri S.R. Nair to present a memento to Dr. Harris. And I request S.R. Nair to do the job again and present a memento to Dr. Srinatha Shastri. Thank you, everyone. Next, we have a small announcement to make. I request Murali Bukkapatnam, President of Thai Hyderabad, to make an announcement regarding the Thai Entrepreneurship Summit, which is happening next week. Okay, sorry, he's not here, so I guess somebody else will do it later. Is PK Agarwal in the house? Okay, we'll do it later. Next, we come to the last bit of the morning session. I'd like to introduce Sri S.R. Nair, who's... Okay. We're going to save time. I'm just going to request Sri S.R. Nair to present the program highlights and also propose the word of thanks. Sir?
The computer was supposed to be here. Laptop. I'm supposed to be showing you the venue and telling you what is happening where, but unfortunately the laptop has not come yet. What I'll do in the meanwhile is to read out a message from our industry minister, Mr. Kunyarikutty, who was supposed to have been here today. He says, "Dear delegates, it gives me immense pleasure to know that Thai Kerala is organizing the second edition of ThaiCon. This follows the hugely successful event last year, which saw nearly 2,000 delegates comprising of thought leaders, entrepreneurs, startup companies, venture capitalists, educationalists, and students to participate and benefit from several brainstorming sessions spread over 2 days. The theme for ThaiCon this year, Prosperity Through Entrepreneurship, is particularly relevant as we see innovation and entrepreneurship as important way forward for youth of the state. Not only does it create increased economic activity, but also serves as a catalyst for wealth creation. The spirit of entrepreneurship needs to be unleashed so that the youth of Kerala are not merely employment seekers, but employment providers as well. I would have liked to be there in your midst, but due to certain personal commitments, I am unable to make it. I take this opportunity to congratulate Thai for organizing this event. The government of Kerala is indeed happy to partner Thai Kerala in this initiative. I wish each and every one of you 2 days of meaningful engagement. We thank him for his message. What's going to happen? It has been announced in the beginning by Mr. Jimon, that is Mr. A.V. George, that we have added more tracks. The two tracks that we've added, one is the Pitch Festival and the other is something called SIG, Special Interest Group. Now, in the end of this PPT, I'll also show you the venue, and I'm also sure that all of you had been given this booklet. The inner page gives you the venue very clearly and also tells you as to which are all the places parallelly these tracks are happening. Some of you may not have seen this place as to how this is laid out, but the fact is that you are entrepreneurs and I'm very sure you will find your way to this place. That is actually the beauty of entrepreneurship. Now, here, how to take the best out of this is what we have a mentoring track, entrepreneurship track, sector tracks, that is called sector SIG, pitch fest. People are invited to pitch for the projects and then get benefited and awarded, and special interest track. And these are on the subject of agriculture, education, health and wellness, manufacturing, tourism, IT, retail, and women entrepreneurship. And special interest track meeting also is happening, 15-minute sessions of general interest, workshop on entrepreneurship and identified topics, and which you see there under that various topics like cyber crimes, entrepreneurial opportunities in Canada, starting business in the US, my story sessions. How do you plan your 2 days? You go through the booklet that is given to you and find out which are all the subjects of your interest that you would like to attend and where is it being held. There are four halls called Manapuram 1, 2, 3, 4. There's a Nayanar hall behind it, and there is space frame which is open for the events and the entertainment today evening. And I'm very sure you will, in the course of time, find out where is this located. You understand, look at the schedule, figure out the sessions that you want, identify the speakers that you want to hear, focus on the sector that you're interested in, plan your networking. Critical, and that is what Ms. Shastri had said, link. Thai actually links. So this is the best opportunity for you to get linked to peers and, of course, big time venture capitalists and others. And exchange cards, make copious notes. That's what the person who made actually this presentation do, Rajesh, he made the presentation. He makes copious notes, actually. Then mentoring pitch festival, please fill in the application. Prepare for a 20-minute presentation, practice your pitch and listen carefully. And exchange cards and make up. Okay, you'll be told during time. This is what are the takeaways? You can hear interesting speeches. You can make very interesting contacts. You can get encouraged by the entrepreneurial stories. You can retain the nuggets and the wisdom and feel charged to succeed. And what you see here is the layout. It's a very busy slide. So anyway, it is available in your booklet, and that's what it is. And that's about the program. We have volunteers plenty available to take you where you want to go. And therefore, I wouldn't want to venture. This is too late a time for me to get into details. Now, let me get into my job of thanking the speakers and the dignitaries. Now, our chief minister was here. Last year, he stayed through. In fact, he stayed till the end of this meet. Probably he may be much busy man today with the changing environment happening, so he need to leave early. But it must definitely be said that if there is an entrepreneurial culture that has happened in the state of Kerala, the person who started is Sri Umman Chandy, Chief Minister of Kerala, and that credit must go to him. And we are very glad that he's creating that mindset, he's changing the mindset of people and creating a culture of entrepreneurship. We also share his excitement, which he had said that he is excited about the entrepreneurial times happening. We are so happy that he won Kerala to be the startup capital of Kerala. Very good. So probably Kochi being at the head, we will be at the right in the middle of it, startup capital of Kerala. In his absence, I profusely, on behalf of Thai and on behalf of all of you, thank him in his absence. Yeah, applause is allowed. Right. Now, let me come to the person who disseminates energy wherever he goes. And last couple of years, he has been doing it all over the world. And he has this funny habit of making emails sitting at some 25,000, 30,000 feet above the ground. Sends his emails to people continuously. And today he has told us, talked to us about the power of one. Power of one. Last year he talked to us about innovation in entrepreneurship. Sir, it was a fantastic presentation. It was lots of takeaways. Thank you very much for that. And thank you for the energy that you disseminate, and even at this age. You talked about this. You talked about these three apples. We are happy that you're coming from a country which has a big apple. But in Kerala, we have one apple which is not apple, and that is pineapple. Okay. On behalf of all of us present here, on behalf of Thai, we indeed thank you for your presence and continuously look forward to seeing you here on year-on-year basis. Thank you very much, sir. Yeah, we have actually, we don't get astronauts every day to speak to us. And if that is an astronaut turned entrepreneur, it's all the more big. So what we thought that we will not actually want him to share a podium like this. We said we'll exclusively give him 1 hour. So that's what is going to happen tomorrow, sir. Tomorrow morning, first thing in the morning, come in good numbers, listen to this wonderful person, a doctor turned astronaut turned entrepreneur. You will hear him tomorrow. I'm going to take him soon after this. I'm going to take him to speak to the students. There are about 500 students waiting out there in Abad Nucleus Mall to listen to this astronaut. Okay? So, and he had landed up with his lovely partner today morning. But one thing is very certain. For a person who has traveled through the space, he is not supposed to get jet lag. Right, sir? You're not supposed to have jet lag. So that's it. So you saw him landing up in the morning and pitch at 10 o'clock here. On behalf of Thai Kerala, on behalf of all these people who are assembled here, so we thank you and we look forward to listening to you tomorrow morning. Thank you very much. We have Mr. P.H. Kurian. Yeah. So he everywhere he goes, he says that actually the shackles actually come from the bureaucrats. And he's out there to undo that. And we have been seeing him doing that. And he told about some 2-3 policies that they are actually pursuing to see that helps entrepreneurs of all class. A real grounded person. He doesn't have any aura or any of those bells and whistles of Indian administrative service around him. A common man, a grounded person, our person. Sir, we are with you in your endeavors. Thank you very much for being here. By the quantum of the money received from State Bank of India, I should be thanking him first. We should thank him, actually. And as he rightly said, he said he saw two things in us. One is the sincerity that we have showed.
We are on par.
Yeah. I stand corrected. The government of Kerala says whatever SBI has done, we also had put in. Thank you very much, sir. Okay. I think that should be corrected. Thank you. Now, as he rightly said, when we went to meet him, he said the sincerity had appealed him. And he said lots of his people who met him are his customers, so he couldn't disappoint him also. And at the same time, want to be part of this journey of entrepreneurship and startup capital and all those things. Said, I'm telling you, the wise decision. Be with us. We are going to be with you. We'll take this forward. Thank you very much for being here. And thank you especially for giving us the funds. Now, thanks will be said in the course of time as we take the day through. When we have sessions going to happen. Soon after this, you're going to see another wonderful session. We are seeing three great entrepreneurs whom, if I say in Malayalam, Guru Tulyan Maraya Moona Sambrambagar. We're going to listen to them and to take the conversation. We also requested Mr. Johnny Lucas of Manorama to do that. He would be doing this soon after this. And similar to that, Mr. P.H. Kurian will be talking to Kerala Entrepreneurship, and then we take the day through as far as entrepreneurship track is concerned. Other 5-6 tracks are open. Please look at your booklets and see how you want to wear and how you want to attend it. It's a too late a time. I must thank you all for a very, very patient listening, and wish you all a very enriching day today and tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you all the dignitaries for joining us. Because we are behind schedule, we will take a very short break of 10 minutes and continue with our respective sessions. So please be back in your sessions in 10 minutes. Thank you.